All right, hello everyone.
Hi.
Hopefully you all had a good good weekend. Sorry, I'm kind of hitting the screen here. This is our last session, so that's a bit of a bummer, but hopefully it's been a good semester and you've gotten a lot out of this class. just do some things here. Okay. I posted the video. I didn't actually do a drawing. I figured I'll just start the painting for this class. I think it'll go by pretty quick. And so hopefully you got a chance to watch the video for last week's module. And I talked a little bit.
I forgot all about it and I didn't watch it because I haven't been well. And
oh,
are we in 15 or are we in 16?
This is week 16 now, so we're at the end. Yeah. But that's fine. I'll go over that module that we missed last week really quickly. Usually it takes some time. But I'll kind of zoom through it and I'll talk a little bit about this week's module. That way I can get to the painting and kind of get it almost complete, hopefully. We'll see. So we're going to jump right into that. Let's see. Any questions for me right now? Anything?
Nothing. Which one was that? Unit 15?
Talking about?
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Yeah.
And again, it's all sort of available. Oh, you know what? One other thing is, I haven't done it yet, but I will be downloading all of these Zoom meetings and uploading them. So that way you can watch the demos on my personal YouTube channel. So I will post a link to that. It's not going to happen right away. It's going to take me some time to kind of like download and upload and all that. But it will be available for you to watch. And
how do we find it? You said on YouTube?
Yeah, I'm gonna give you a link.
Okay.
I'll send an announcement out before the.
Yeah.
Will
we be able to access these modules in here?
So I believe you have like a year to access the modules. I don't know if that's a school year. Like, I don't know if it resets over summer or if it's sort of a calendar year. But I do know that you do have access to the information in the class, maybe not the assignments per se, but it still exists for a little bit. So any of the any of the readings that you want to save, you'd have to kind of go through and make sure that you save those, like screenshot them or whatever. But I will be doing sort of the upload of the weekly Zoom sessions. So that way you have access to them kind of outside of Canvas and just at any time you want. Okay, so last week, what did we cover? We didn't cover anything, but last week was about the beauty in the banal. And what I'm talking about here is just this idea of making images that are just as important as, you know, maybe these things that are grander or more monumental. When we make paintings, we want to try to, like, I feel like it's a normal thing to want to find the perfect moment or the most beautiful thing or like the most grand visual gesture possible. So we're looking for like monumental moments. But sometimes it's not about like that monumental kind of thing or that very beautiful thing either. It could be very mundane. And sometimes those mundane moments are just as important as these monumental moments. And it's important that we kind of open ourselves up to kind of investigating those things through art. So I have a little kind of thing here that you can read through and talk about, but I feel like this is sort of a good one. And also, kind of before I jump on, sorry, you know, this idea of beauty and what we think is beautiful or what we think is sort of worthwhile of taking pictures tends to be kind of generic. It tends, like, our sense of beauty and what is aesthetically pleasing is informed by the things that we see. And the things that we see is sort of like, you know, we always hear about this like algorithm on like on Instagram, where all we see is the same kind of people or the same thing, and it's not really changing. And that's sort of been true kind of forever, that we kind of repeat these same moments and share these experiences, and that informs our aesthetic values, but it also limits us because we're not really exploring other things. So I think these photos are kind of funny because it's like, you know, you take this picture of yourself in front of the Eiffel Tower, and I think you enjoy it, and you're like, yeah, I was there, but no one wants to see this picture of of, you know, two people in front of the Eiffel Tower sort of askew. And then all these people taking pictures of their food, like we all take pictures, like we go out to this fancy meal, we take pictures of our food, and it's like, who cares? Like, why are we doing this? Like, why are we participating in this activity? Like, what is the importance of this image if everyone else is sharing the same image, is taking the same photo? And here we have, like, you know, this sort of monumental environment that they're all in, and everyone's taking the same photo, and it's just this kind of repeated thing where everyone is just kind of the same. So I think that's sort of funny. But when it comes to painting, I think it's really important to kind of make a distinction between the activity of painting and the images that we're making and sort of the weight that we're placing on these images. So here I have three paintings of roses, all done in very different styles. There's not one that's better than the other. I mean, they're sort of subject to your own personal taste. But the point that I kind of want to talk about is that these paintings, as good as they are not nearly as good as the actual rose. They'll never be as good as the real thing. These are just imitations. Art is mimesis, and what that means is art is mimicry. It's just copying something that is real. And the real thing is the important thing, not the painting, right? So as pretty as these roses are in painting, they don't smell like a rose. They don't have the same sort of textural sort of thinness that the rose petals have, that kind of cool, it's kind of like, it might be a little sticky sometimes. I don't know. It's like you can feel it, and it's like a very tactile sensation, and you can smell it, and you can see the colors, and you can see the way the light kind of shines through it and the shadows that they cast. And painting or photo even is so singular. It doesn't have the same kind of resonance that the actual object has. But what that does allow is it allows painting to really just think about painting separate from the subject matter. We know roses are beautiful, but you know, we don't need paintings to tell us roses are beautiful. But what we can investigate as painters is beautiful painting. And so what I mean by that is, if we look at the three different examples here, you know, we've got this really kind of blocky, chunky version of a rose where we can see the brush strokes. We can see kind of the thickness of the paint. In this far one on the right, you know, it's very kind of calligraphic. It's not as chunky as this. It's still very painterly. And it reads like very cavalier, very kind of carefree. And then we have something here where the painting is more meticulous and the details are kind of higher. There's no like real brush strokes. And, you know, when we look at these paintings beyond just looking at the subject matter of a rose, because like it's a rose. Great job. We can look at the quality and the style that they used in terms of painting. And so that kind of opens up the door of, once we kind of, you know, sort of push off the subject matter, then we start to look at the physicality or like the presence of the painting. And that's more important than a painting of a rose. It's how the rose was painted, like this or like this or like this. So painting is painting. And that's really kind of, it sounds like a very obvious thing. Like you're like, yeah, we paint and that's that. But to me, I feel like it's something that gets overlooked. You know, we tend to want that image that looks good. We want to choose an image to work from that looks good and make a painting that looks good. And really what we should be focusing on is painting good. Painting well. Moving on, you know, I talk a little bit about the banal, but I'll sort of build up to that here in a few. And then I really like this video. I forget what it's called. Something, the Dictionary of Infinite Sorrows or something like that. But this is Vima Dalan. And they're just made up words, and it's this guy that has kind of compiled images related to these definitions that he's kind of created. And this is the fear that everything has been photographed. And so what's cool about this video is, if you watch it, it's like all of these great photos that people want to take, you know, like of themselves, like here in like a car mirror. You watch this video and it's like hundreds of videos of photos that are all the same, very aesthetically kind of considered and curated. Like very, each photo is intentional and like, it's intentional. But what ends up happening is you just end up seeing like hundreds of photos that are all exactly the same, with everyone trying to be original. So that's that one. But working our way kind of towards this idea of the banal, and the banal is like you know, very mediocre, very common, very boring. I kind of want to talk about sort of opposite and work our way up to it. You know, one of the things that has always kind of been important in art is, you know, the people that are paying for it kind of want to see the world that they live in. And so we tend to see, especially in early kind of iterations of artwork in like modern art or modernism, we see this shift from kind of art for patrons versus art for artists. But when we talk about art for patrons, you know, those are the people buying stuff. So they want to see the world they live in. And so those would be kings and queens and royalty and the rich and the church. And that's something that's kind of carried through history. And so when we look at these like older paintings here, you know, there it's showing sort of this grand room. Like, look at this canvas, this giant canvas that's being painted, and the room is huge. The kids are all here and they're dressed in like very fancy clothes, and there's people attending to them. And then we see like a mirror over here with the two people that are sitting. Like, we are the sitters. And you know, they're about to get a portrait done of themselves on this canvas that is like larger than life. So this is very much about kind of showing off like sort of this extravagance and how much there is and how kind of intricate it is. And when we look at this one here, you know, we got this lady in this really kind of amazing, frilly dress on a swing, just kind of leisurely, you know, not working at all, not a care in the world, her shoes flying off. She's not even actually swinging. There's someone swinging her. Like, that's how enjoyable her life is. She just gets to get, you know, do fun things. And it's not just necessarily about like riches, but it's what I'm talking about is like this abundance and excess of things around us. So we've got this Bosch painting of kind of all of the kind of earthly delights and sort of the results of those things. So it's very hedonistic and kind of grotesque at times, but there's so much going on. And then in this Friedrich painting, there's, you know, just this amazing expanse that people would never, you know, back when this was painting, people never got to go here. Like, they didn't see photos of this. So this was like an effort to kind of share this great world that is so far away with others. So it's very kind of vast and expansive. Same thing here. We've got like a carnival kind of thing, like a celebration. And this is a contemporary painter. This is Kehinde Wiley. And you know, he's pulling from kind of that painting of Napoleon, very, very regal. You know, he's got this really opulent frame, this sort of patterning that is out of context to the rest of the painting, you know, and this painting is huge. It's like a really large image. This is, oh my gosh, I forgot. it's going to come to me and I'll say it later, but why can't I think of it? It's going to bug me. But you know, this is a photo of the 99 cent store, and nothing here is too expensive. It's, you know, it's the 99 cent store, but there's just so much of it. It's just sort of endless and kind of gargantuan. And this photo is printed huge. It's like maybe a 8-foot by 5-foot photograph, maybe even bigger than that. And so like the relationship to the way that we see the world is sometimes this huge kind of thing that becomes overwhelming. And so when I talk about extravagance and opulence, it includes that sort of attitude. This is Picasso, Guernica, and kind of the same thing. You know, this is about war, though. It's not sort of celebratory. It's not candy. It's not consumable in the same way. So this has kind of like that, almost like the Bosch quality where, you know, there's all of this sort of destruction and anguish kind of happening all over the place. And there's so much of it. And this is Yayoi Kusama. And this is an installation inside the Broad, but she's done it in other places as well. And it's an infinity room. And so you walk out on this platform here, and the room is covered in mirrors, and the floor has a layer of water, so it's reflective, and the ceiling also has mirrors. And there's all of these little Christmas lights just kind of hanging inside the room. But what happens is, because the mirror reflects and it reflects behind you, it just goes on forever and ever and ever. And it's very overwhelming, and it's really amazing to kind of be immersed in it. You have to like wait in line to go to this thing and experience it. And so everyone takes their like selfie pictures or mirror pictures inside this room. Because part of it is they've seen other people take that same photo, and so they want to take that photo rather than maybe, I don't know, being in the moment and sort of experiencing the kind of infinite void that you're stepping into, which is kind of more exciting. And this is Tara Donovan, and these are styrofoam cups that are all glued together. And you can see kind of the scale. This is a like doorway. So this thing is just this huge cloud that hovers above your head, and it's got lights kind of shining through it. And it's really quite amazing, because you don't really understand that it is styrofoam cups until you sit there and look at it, because it's just this amazing structure inside of a building. And it doesn't quite make sense. It like curves and bulges in really interesting ways. So there's a place for that kind of attitude of extravagance, of monumentality. And it kind of builds into this next bit of information that I want to talk about, which is camp and kitsch. When we talk about things being campy or kitschy, that's a word that kind of gets thrown around, especially with, you know, especially when we watch movies by Wes Anderson or John Waters. Like those are kind of campy and kitschy movies. But when we talk about camp, we kind of relate it back to Susan Sontag. And she wrote an essay called Notes on Camp, and I have it here so you can read that if you're interested. And if you're online at all, you know, recently it's been very kind of popular to see what people wear to the Met Gala, the Met being the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and they throw this huge kind of event where celebrities get invited and they dress up kind of funny or weird, kind of more extravagant, more outrageous than say a standard red carpet affair. This is like where Jared Leto was just wearing like a cat costume, or people are like covered in diamond dust. The theme for the gala changes, but a couple years ago it was camp. Like the theme was to be as campy as possible. And so I have a little video here on that. And when we talk about camp or kitsch, those two words sometimes get used interchangeably, But I think it's important to kind of make a distinction. And it's hard to really define what these things are specifically. But from kind of all the information that I've gathered and kind of figured out, it's Kitsch is like being a little bit naive about things that are boring or bad. And not liking them ironically. It's like you like them like genuinely. So Kitsch would be like if you visited, say, like a grand aunt, and you know she collected weird things, and it's weird to you, so but she was very genuine about it. That would be kind of kitschy. Camp is purposefully liking those things, either through irony or being genuinely into them, but then also knowing that they're generally kind of lower brow. Does that make sense? Yeah, I think so. So camp is more intentional, let's say. And it's really hard to tell where those differences are. And sometimes that line is, you know, it changes and shifts. We look at this Andy Warhol painting, and this is very campy. You know, here we've got Elvis, this like Hollywood hunky kind of guy. And Warhol is making this thing where, you know, he likes Elvis so much, he's making a painting of three of him. He's like, there's not enough Elvis. We need more Elvis. and so here's, you know, here's a painting of, like, you want it, you got it kind of thing. Like, here's a lot of Elvis for you. This is also kind of campy, you know, like she's probably 20 something, 30 something. And she's kind of purposefully collecting these very, you know, antiquated, maybe like 70s, 60s era tchotchkes. That's another word that gets thrown around with camp and kitsch, or tchotchkes. Kind of like, I don't know what these are, like Hummel doll kind of things, chihuahuas and Sesame Street. This is Jeff Koons, and this is, you know, a balloon dog made out of metal and finished with like really high polished kind of anodization. But it's just like a silly little thing that you would get like at a fair. But now it's this like iconic thing that it's sort of transcended being campy. It's all of a sudden now this cultural thing. Live, laugh, love. I mean, just the overall kind of attitude or the style, it's people genuinely, you know, are interested in this thing, and that might be kind of kitschy. It doesn't seem like they like the aesthetics and they like the message, and there's not really a level of awareness, but you know, they saw it at their friend's house and they want it too. So, you know, they got it. We got like the whole lumberjack aesthetic, you know, flannel shirts and beards and like axes. And this guy's probably not cut down a tree before, but it's very much part of like, you know, we see it in the world and we want to be part of it. We want to experience it too. And with no real awareness of kind of the irony or anything, or what real lumberjacks are like. Got a gold toilet by Maurizio Catalan. Very campy. These are costumes created by the artist Nick Cave. And they're made of like doilies and stuffed animals and fake flowers and kind of pulling from you know, probably this woman's shelf here, like all these things, and then he turns it into this here. Then we got Vegas. Like Las Vegas is kind of the ultimate campy place. It's, you know, we've got an Eiffel Tower here next to New York, next to a castle, next to a pyramid. And it's just like kind of crazy, intentional, maybe unintentionally ironic, and all of those things happening simultaneously. So it's hard to tell if this is camp or kitsch. This is Mark Ryden, very inspired by the big guy's kind of 70s paintings. We've got the city of Solvang. If any of you have never been, it's kind of a strange place, and it's worth going to at least once in your life. it's a little bit like a section of an amusement park, but this is the whole city, and people are committed to kind of carrying out these roles of like a small Dutch town. So they're dressed in kind of the garb, and they put on street shows, I guess. They're like singing and dancing, and it's just, it's a normal city, and you're like, you're just looking for a Best Buy or something. You're looking for the closest Costco. but it's close to Santa Barbara. And when I was going to school, I would go there maybe once a month because they have like really good desserts. And so I'd go up there for like apple pie.
Can I say something, Mark? This is Kylie.
Yeah.
I'm going to retire in Solvang.
Oh, cool. Yeah. It's fun. I mean, it's a strange place, but it's a lot of fun, and you're like, how did this end up here in kind of the middle of California? Yeah, so if you've never been, I recommend going. And then lastly, we have Dali. And Dali, I think, he's not trying to be campy or kitschy. He's not trying to be kind of twee or ironic at all. He's very interested in the things that he was interested in. But I think at this stage, at this point in time, you know, Dali is, the people that like him are maybe a little campy or kitschy. He's a fantastic painter, don't get me wrong. His images are really amazing. But, you know, for the same reason that like the Mona Lisa is popular or Van Gogh's Starry Night is popular, they're great paintings. But there's a reason that like everyone kind of knows them, and I don't know what that reason is, but it does kind of qualify it into this realm of being overly popular and kind of devoid of meaning. People like it just because they like it, or just because they saw it in someone's house or something. And then as we shift kind of away from sort of the extravagant stuff and kind of campy things, we get into this territory of banal stuff, like things that are not as important. And you know, this is a really great video on kind of a moment that frames a whole story with kind of banal information, and so it's like really common things and just nothing fantastic about it. But what's really important is that there's something familiar, and so that familiarity is kind of the thing that we use to communicate with each other. And so I have this video, and I have it queued up to play about a scene, but the whole video is great, so I really recommend watching it. And then I have another video here on this artist. I think this is through LACMA, I forget, but it's an artist who has taken a photo of, let me see, it's weird to play, I don't know if I can play a video. I just want to show you the photo here. So the photo is through a building being constructed and then into sort of the sea of houses that were constructed, another level of development, and then another layer of sort of the empty expanse. And this is it's really kind of a fantastic photo because it, like, we all are very familiar with this landscape. And, you know, it's something that we see or that we live in all the time. You know, if you've seen kind of houses being built and more houses being built and more houses being built, that's sort of the kind of Southern California thing. This should be very familiar. So it's actually very boring and not that great, you know, but it's kind of great in its presentation of information that is familiar. And so, you know, we continue that train of thought. Here we have another painting by Andy Warhol, thinking back to the Elvis painting. Elvis is this, like, you know, entertainer, and then the next thing he paints is soup, like soup that's in everyone's pantry. So he goes from this thing that is, like, you know, larger than life to this thing that is, like, so basic and boring, and he makes paintings of both. This is a urinal by Duchamp. It's just something that he bought from the store, signed it with R. Mutz, and brought it to the museum, and there it is. And then here we've got a painting by Manet, and, you know, while this woman is fancy and this guy's in a nice suit, there's nothing spectacular happening. This is just a moment that they're at rest. They're not looking at the painter. They're not even looking at each other. They're just kind of, like, waiting for something else to happen. And so this is a very banal, kind of boring moment in time. They don't look particularly sad or happy or anything. It's just sort of inert, kind of a stolen moment. This is a painting by Gerhard Richter of a woman reading a newspaper. Again, nothing spectacular. But it's in that kind of basicness that it becomes amazing, that it becomes so much more than, like, bombs going off or, you know, animals kind of attacking each other. This is a painting by Richard Estes, and it's amazing. It's, like, so detailed and well crafted, but it's of just, like, a few telephone booths and in front of a diner and, like, a cracked sidewalk. And then that's just, like, yeah, well, it's not something we see all the time. I mean, we don't see telephone booths anymore, but when this was painted, they were all over the place. This is Cindy Sherman, and she, in this series, she was recreating film stills for films that never existed. So she's, like, using the aesthetic of films. And so they're always, like, those kind of stolen moment scenes or shots. So here's that one. And then this is a photo by Jeff Wall. And everything in here, like, it looks like he walked into someone's house or apartment and took a picture and then, like, left. But everything in this photo is curated. It's placed and positioned. And these are actors that he's hired to kind of, like, stand in the spot. So, like, everything that's happening here, aside from maybe the background of, like, the cityscape, like the lamp and the chairs and, like, this person doing laundry and this person reading magazines and these flowers on the shelf. All of that was staged. So it's very curated, but it's made to look very candid. And then this is a sculpture by Dwayne Hansen, and it's of a guy just standing on a ladder. And it looks like just a guy standing next to a ladder that's like one of the workers inside the gallery as they do an install. You know, from the crummy shoes and the paint splattered pants and the ladder that, you know, is just there. It's kind of amazing that it's this sculpture, and this is actually, you know, it's not a person. It's like it's an actual sculpture. You know, it's something that we wouldn't pay any attention to, or that we'd purposefully try to avoid and like not look at. And it's definitely not the things that we would think are worthy of being made into art. But here it is. And so we, you know, when we talk about that idea of worthy of being made into art, that's kind of this approach. That's the reason for this this assignment, is that we're taking these things that are not fantastic and elevating them by focusing our attention, by turning our eye and putting our brush to paper or canvas, whatever it is. We are telling other people to pay attention to these things. We're in control. We're allowed to kind of say, hey, look at this thing that you wouldn't normally think to care about. This is a Franz Klein painting, and that's Franz Klein here. And so I just have this image here because it's very much about painting, and that's kind of the attitude of all painters, and it should be the attitude of all painters. And his painting is about his physicality. It's about the distance of his arm reach. And that's sort of devoid of subject matter. So it's things that you need to also consider as we approach other subject matter too. So it's like two things simultaneously. It's the act of painting and it's the subjects that we cover. So stuff to consider. Some artists to look at and think about. We've got Phil Donahue, and that's not the TV host. This is a photographer from LA. And he takes pictures of kind of forgotten places that have been maybe abandoned, not literally, but sort of left behind in the times. This is like an old Taco Bell that he was able to find. It's probably a different restaurant now, but you know, they kept the same seats and the same kind of architecture. This is the Hemet Mall, and it's like, you know, just a guy walking into a mall. But you know, this is a pretty common thing throughout the entire nation, just like empty storefronts and like, you know, in this, especially down here in California, you know, this like coral tan stucco architecture. Here we've got three people sitting inside of, I think this is Inland Center Mall inside in San Bernardino. And this could be any time and any place and in any mall kind of throughout the world. This is Nick McPhail. And these are just paintings of like hidden kind of pieces of architecture, so places that don't normally get paid attention to. So we've got the stair landing at the front face with the shadows dappled across it, a lawn being watered, This looks like one of those electrical boxes with a tree next to it. And so these are places that we wouldn't normally think are worth making paintings or even paying attention to. And these are great, great paintings. And this is Nick Farhi. And I like it. I describe it as like he's stuck in his parents' house in the 80s. So he's making paintings of like Pyrex dishes or Corningware or, you know, like things that you might find at like a swap meet. You know, this oven has like the appropriate avocado color walls. Some mugs, an old toaster. And if you've ever been to an estate sale, it kind of has that feeling as well. Like you're walking through an estate sale and this is like the pitcher and cup set that's available for $20. So for this assignment, it's really about thinking about your subject matter and trying to do something fairly basic, but then also thinking about the quality of painting that you're doing, and using this as an opportunity, even though it's maybe not the most extravagant object, this is a chance to kind of focus in on the level of painting that you're putting into it. You know, we've covered still lifes and we've worked from photos of like exotic animals and we've done non-representational paintings. So now this is us kind of scaling it back in terms of like subject matter and really kind of allowing you to think about paint. I'm just gonna skip through. And I'm going to keep going here and then we'll get into the painting. This was a demo. I found these pens that are erasable pens and they erase through friction through the heat. So you can actually use a hairdryer to erase them. So this is kind of a cool little demo on that. And then moving into week 16, that's this week. I just have some information about some different kinds of ideas and ways that you might approach painting further. This is texture and dealing with texture. So there's like the difference between physical texture, that would be like thicker paint applied to the surface, or painting texture. So it looks like it. So it's like imitating imitating texture. Here we've got actual thick paint. And then here we've got Glen Brown. Actually, these are both Glen Brown. Glen Brown making paintings that look like they're kind of gloppy and smushy, but they're really like flat and thin. Now these are more related to kind of oil painting techniques, but there's still valuable information that helps you understand how to kind of break down different textures. So this is a great painting instruction on, you know, we've got metallic surfaces, we've got fabric in the back, and then we also have sort of the fuzzy kind of softness of the peach. And he does a great job of kind of demonstrating all of those things. This is specifically about metallic and reflective surfaces. And then monoprinting is a way of bringing texture in through like using different tools and some other devices. So those are just some fun informational videos. And then also another thing to kind of consider is scale. You know, so far in this class, I've worked on 11 by 15. Some of you have been working really big, some of you have been working small. But I think it's important to kind of think about how does scale change the way that a painting is received or looked at. There's a couple different things to consider when it comes to scale. That's the just the initial scale, and that could be like, well, how big of a piece of paper or canvas are you painting on? Is it like tiny, like, you know, like an index card? Is it big, like the size of a wall? That relationship that the physical surface has to a viewer can really shift the way that we interpret information. This is a Persian painting, and it's 8 inches by 11 inches, and it's just chock full of density. Like, look at all the detail. You know, on my screen, I've got a big kind of 24 inch screen here in front of me. At this scale, this painting is probably close to 1-to-1 for me. And I couldn't even imagine painting all of these like little details in here. All of these like little, you know, pieces of each leaf or each feather of this duck down there. And so the scale, you know, the tightness of painting kind of shifts. And then that could also kind of work sort of in the opposite way. Here we've got a painting by Claire Tabaret, or actually a bunch of paintings that she's working on. And these things are huge. Look, this is the artist right there. And these must be, I don't know, 20 feet. 20 feet by maybe 8 feet. And so it becomes this amazing thing. It's like this huge undertaking. And so that kind of shifts our understanding of the visuals. Now we can mix and match these things too. So if we look at Tabaret's painting here, you know, the painting is pretty big and it's pretty loose. But imagine painting in this style with like this level of tightness over something this big, or vice versa, painting this loose on something really small. And so that relationship is something that as painters, we have to kind of be aware of, like, what is the size of our painting according to the size of the surface? I've got a little video here on making a mural. That's kind of fun. And then I also have some videos here on just making large scale paintings. I've got something on using stencils. And then this is a squeegee painting by Gerhard Richter, and another billboard painting, or a billboard painting video right there. And then for just some extra kind of information, here's a little tour, a video tour of my studio. It's changed since then. I just share it with Chet Glaze, my friend Ryan Perez. He kind of moved out. So this is just an old video of my studio. And then a few years ago, I gave an artist talk during sort of COVID times. I gave an artist talk about my own work. And so you can watch that video here. And I have another little video with me working and painting. And this was my demo from a couple years ago for my banal painting. So this was just a box of tissue paper and, you know, something that we literally just throw away, like we use it and toss it all the time. So I'm not really paying it any attention. And so I have the kind of video there. And this is an old thing. I'm going to actually erase this. So that was a lot of stuff to cover. before we take a break here, I just want to kind of talk about, like, I'm not probably going to finish this painting, but I'm going to get started on it, and I'll post the finished image to the module once I'm done with it, so you will be able to see that. But it'll be a pretty fun and easy painting, I think, so I should get pretty far with it. We'll go ahead and take a 10-minute break and then come on back and get to painting. Okay? All right.
What's the goal for, like, us to be painting today?
So we're gonna do, like, you know, you're free to kind of paint whatever object you want. So it's like whatever banal thing is there. Okay. And that's really kind of the main thrust, is I want you to maybe shift your focus from, like, finding the most spectacular thing to paint, and maybe just paint something a little bit more common. So, like, a toothbrush, or I'm gonna do a banana for this one.
What about a bowl of SkittyOs?
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, I mean, so really, it's like, you know, as we get to, like, the end of this thing, it's really about, like, everything's fair game. Everything's free for you to paint. Like, whatever you want to do, you could do. Like, if it's the most spectacular, extravagant pieces of jewelry, or, you know, epic kind of thing that's happening, like, that's cool too, you know. Or if it's, like, this quiet, small thing, that's also, you know, reasonable. And that's kind of what I'm trying to maybe push you all towards, is, like, at this stage, you know, if we never see each other again, you know, and you're just going to go paint, you have the freedom and openness to explore and do whatever you want, and everything's fair game. So that's what I want you to think and consider. So we'll go ahead and take that 10-minute break. Oh yes, go ahead,
Linda. So the things that we're working on, how long, like, are you going to go and kind of critique what we've done? And then, like, if I'm working on something now, how long do I have to finish it to post it?
I think we have maybe 2 weeks before the class is, like, shut from sort of on Canvas. But if you email it to me, I'll respond. It might take me a couple days, but I will send my critique directly to you via email. So you could also do that.
And your email, is that on this, we have that, the email?
Yes. Yeah. So it's just my my first initial last name at miracosta.edu.
Is that what we get from you each week to tap into Zoom? Is that yours?
That one's from Canvas, but yeah, I'll post it. It should be in the syllabus, but I'll post it again in an announcement.
Okay, so your first initial, your last name, and at Miracosta.
Yeah, so here, I'll just type it in into the chat. I think that's what it is. I'm pretty sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So it's in the chat. So if you want to copy and paste it, it should be there. And you can contact me anytime after the class ends as well.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So break time, and then we'll come back and paint. Okay. All right. I'm going to get back into this. Feel back yet? Yeah. Okay. So we'll go ahead and get started. This is the painting I'm going to do today. This is a banana, peeled banana on my kitchen counter. And it's bruised and kind of gnarly. But the unbruised part was good. There's a lot of different colors that are happening here. Obviously, yellow is sort of the main kind of thing, but really it's only like yellow here and a little yellow there and some here. There's greens as well, some browns. I'm seeing some reds in here as well as the browns. I'm getting some cool kind of blue grays for out this way and into the shadows. Over here, the tiles look pretty light, and with some reflected yellow orange out this way onto the surface. So it's warmer over here, a little bit cooler over here. I got this like blue highlight over there. For the banana itself, I've got this really bright area right there. That's maybe the brightest thing on the entire image. Like this section right there. So I want to maintain that. So this will be white, whereas the tiles will all have some color and value. But the shadow of this banana is kind of yellowy, like a little warm, so I'll probably use like the complementary mix to dull that out a bit. There's nothing really gray, like, so I don't necessarily need like black on my palette. Everything has some color in it, so that's kind of what I'm gonna do here. Switch over to my overhead cam, and I've already drawn it out. This time I drew it kind of light because I knew that a lot of my colors were going to be a bit on the light side. Actually, it's a little blurry too, so let me see if I can sharpen this up some. Sorry, one second. I don't know what happened to my camera. There you go. And then that looks pretty good. Pretty good. Okay, cool. So that's pretty sharp there. So I drew it a little lighter than I would normally than I normally draw it. So if it's hard to see, it's because of that reason. I mean, obviously, you know, bananas are yellow, kind of on the outside, and on the inside a little on the yellow family. So I just want to try to get as much variation as I can. And that means working with the values as well. All right. My palette is kind of a old palette here. But I've got, this is Van Dyke Brown, Burnt Umber. I have some raw sienna, burnt sienna, raw sienna, magenta, magenta, yellow, yellow, phthalo green, blue, manganese blue, violet, and then I have some Delft blue, which is like an ultramarine, and I have a couple black out here, a couple different little blacks. I don't think I need, maybe in the stem, and then I have a crimson, and I don't know what that is. There's some like brownish color over there. So I mean, my root really is yellow. The body of the banana is kind of more greenish yellow. The kind of meat and the inside of the peel is more of like a grayed out yellow. So that's going to be, say, yellow plus violet. So I'm just going to actually just start this off and spray some water into my colors just to help kind of speed that process up a little bit. So I'm just going to start off with like a light kind of plain yellow, because I can always add variations to this. And it's pretty intense. I think it's a little lighter over here, so I'm going to maybe water it out and add some green to it. But in this area, I think I'm pretty confident that this could just be yellow. And it's important that, you know, as we're making this painting, we're thinking about the values and the shapes and all that, all the stuff that we've been kind of dealing with the entire time. I think it's also, I could have started with a negative space, but the yellow is just kind of easy to dive into here. And this one especially will go a lot darker. I just want to use it as a placeholder for the time being. And then there's some like hints of yellow that are like popping up through different areas of the painting. I'm just going to bring those in where I think they are, letting the brush do that, the work. That's pretty good. Maybe pick up a little bit right there and a little bit like right on the edge. That's easy enough for me to cover. Now there's some green that's happening here. And I want to come into that pretty quickly. So I'm just going to pick up some of this green. I'm going to mix out here. And it's not green, it's yellow with green in it. So I'm going to pick up a lot of this yellow here, mix those two. Actually, this is pretty good right there. So I have like kind of two variations. I'm just going to add water to this one over here. I want it thin and light. Maybe a little more yellow than that. You can kind of see it's these brushes, sorry. There's that. I don't really have any test space that y'all can see. That's fine. There. So this is a very pale greenish yellow. And I'm going to use it for this out here because this is kind of that color. That's good. Right there. That's good. And so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to add more of this green to this. I want it to be kind of greenish. So this is kind of the thicker one, not the transparent one. So a little bit more green in there. And I'm going to use, I'm just going to kind of glaze over the top of this. Just make sure that it's dry. It's drying pretty fast. It's kind of warm today. And this area here is really dark, but I'll just start filling it in pretty light. Now there's like a distinct ridge from here to here, so I want to kind of maintain that. But over on this side, it kind of like blends and fades and shifts. So I'm gonna get some of those in here too, some of these greens. I haven't really shifted any of the values too much because it's still pretty light. So I definitely have to do that too. I just wanna bring in some of this color that I'm seeing. I'll probably do another pass of this green on here too. Maybe just pick up a little bit more yellow and just kind of come in right through there. And then there's some of that green kind of over here, just a little bit. Green right there. And there. I use this, I'll do another little bit of a coat here. Just pick it up right up in this. A little right there. So that's giving me the color profile that I think it needs. But again, I still have to push into those darker values. I'm not too worried about like the bruises just yet. I might come into those in the next, I'm gonna lay down a little bit more yellow, but this time some value yellow, and then I'll do the bruises and then I'll do more yellow. So to make the yellow in value, rather than using black, because black tends to be kind of bluish, which would make it really green colored, I'm gonna use either the complement or some brown. And I'll probably just use some of this brown here. So we've got this brown. Mix that up. Take that pile. Good. And just start adding yellow to that. Maybe a little more brown than that. I think I gotta push this bit further. Some more yellow. More yellow than that. It's a bit greenish. So I'm just trying to build up a little more yellow than too much green. So. All right, I think that's pretty good. So like there's, you know, shadow through here. Oh, that's a lot of paint. Shadow through here. A lot of paint on my brush right now. Yeah, that's good. Okay. There. This is a shadow. I'm just working, building. Get some of those variations that are happening here. That's good. I'm gonna have to let this set for just a second. Good right there. Maybe a little bit of darkness there, so I'm going to offload some of that paint on my brush. Just build those shadows in. Let's put some here on that edge just to build that up. I kind of overshot, so I'm gonna try to clean that up a little so I can just use another small brush with some clean water. I'm just gonna try to knock that little mistake out. I'm just waiting. Can I just backtrack here? So what I'm doing now is I'm looking at these bruises and just maybe painting kind of the edge of where those bruises are, just so there's like some of that color variation. They're much more red than this, but this kind of gives me like an idea of where things should be. And it also kind of makes it not as dark as what some of it actually is. So I can kind of build up to it in a more kind of controlled manner. So I'm just letting that paint kind of build and get a little heavier in some places. I'm just working my way around. That wasn't even really a color change. I was just letting that paint kind of build up. Let that dry for a second. I'm going to take some of this yellow and just put it here in a pile. I'm going to take some of this reddish brown. Put those two together. A little bit more than that. So I'm trying to mix out maybe that bruised color. And I think I need some darker color in there. So I'm gonna pick up some of this Van Dyke brown. Just bring that down a little bit. All right, that's pretty good. It's not black, which is what I want to avoid. It's a bit redder because of this burnt umber. I'm just trying to decide if I want to switch to a different brush. I think this brush is fine, honestly. Oh, still a bit wet, so I gotta wait. When I squint at the image, and actually let me kind of disappear from view. When I squint at the image, this area here is really dark. So I need to make sure that I go as far as I have to in order to make it look as dimensional as possible. So I have to make sure that I push those values further, build up into that, and really get it in the value range that it needs to be. All right, I think I'm going to paint here. All right, so for this, I'm going for the bruises and some of the darker kind of elements. So I'll start off with just the, oh man, there's not enough paint on here. It's a bit thin, so I'm going to try to take some of that water out, which really just means I'm just mixing more paint into it. I'm going to pick up some blue here just to darken that out a bit. Got to see where it's at. Just dry my brush off. Loading it up with some paint. There's some variation in here, just like some inconsistencies from the scratches. I'm not trying to do it too linear, but there are some like weird like lines and artifacts that I feel like I can pick up on. Subtle's always kind of better. It's easier to add things than it is to take it away. So I'll keep that in mind. Just kind of building on what I have. That's pretty good. I'm going to get up into the stem here. I want a heavy amount of paint. I want this to be dark, so. So it's a little pulled up, but that's fine. I'm going to just build into that and let that paint kind of rest on itself. So, all right. We do the same thing right here. We're just going to build that up a bit darker than where it's at. Also, some other elements out here. That's not even anything. But this one here, that bruise. And dark here. All right, cool. Because it went on a little thick, I have to sort of wait a bit just to let it dry up. I don't want it to bleed into anywhere else. We can rest for a second. Let that dry. Gauge my progress. I think I can go greener here. I still need to bring in those darker values there. And then after I do that part, I'll shift gears and move on to, say, the inside of the banana or the negative space. I haven't decided yet. Maybe the negative space, that'll help kind of ground things out a little bit, a little bit better. But I don't want to rush. Everything's so light and it's so thin and transparent. I don't want to rush like letting this, which is really thick and heavy right now, bleed off into kind of the negative space. So I'm just gonna sit and wait. Excuse me. For this negative space, I will probably use a little bit of black, just to kind of speed this process along, and some of this like blue that I have sitting out, because it's light, I don't need a lot. I'm just going to pick up some of that black paint here and here. So that's a lamp black and a I don't know what the other one is. A lamp and a Mars. Mars black. Looked like there's a little white in this palette. So I ended up graying out kind of opaquely. Which is fine. It's pretty watered down right now. And then I want some, not a lot of blue, just a little bit. I'm just trying to cool it down ever so slightly. Maybe a little more gray than that. Oh, I'm sorry, it's off. There it is. Off screen. All right. I think that's a pretty good general color that I have here. It's very thin, so it won't go down like super dark. It just looks dark on the screen. And I'm just going to cover the whole thing with this, and then I could maybe build in the tiles a little bit later. Okay, more water than that. So it was a little too dark, so I just dunked my brush in some water, and I'm just moving whatever paint is on the surface around. I'm just using a big brush to kind of like move through as quickly as possible. And the color is hard to see on the screen, but it is there. There is a visual difference. That's a little lighter out towards the back end of it. So I'm just gonna keep building up some of this color here and then use just some water to move that paint up and away and just make it a little lighter as it gets further from the subject. I'm going to use the same color over here. I know that there's like a little yellowy orange happening, but this is so soft and subtle that I could glaze over the top of it. With that color, and it'll be fine. Oh, right in there, that sort of orange color. Good job. A few spots here. I'm gonna use the same blue and just start, while I'm here, just start building up some of these shadows. I like using a big brush because it keeps me a bit clumsy, and not overly too tight or detailed. I kind of prefer that. Especially with this negative space, because then it just starts to maybe read less rendered and just the way that I like it to look. All right. Then I could also use the same color, and there's tiles here. So there's like, the tiles are a little bit raised, and so I end up with like a light side and a dark side. Rather than trying to over render it, I'm just going to maybe go lightly along the grout line, but let it kind of break apart. Like it's dark going this way, but kind of light going this way. So I'm not going to do all of it consistently. So further back, it's a little darker. Up close, we get a little bit more detail. I also want to kind of consider the thickness of line that I'm using as I do this. So a little thin, just like a suggestion. Oh, it's still wet. I gotta wait. I'm gonna knock that down just so it doesn't. Just sit there. So just use a clean dry brush to get rid of it. Squinting at it, I do feel like I can go a little bit darker than where I have the negative space right now. But I'll do that after I do the grout line. That'll happen here in a few minutes. Yeah, it's a bit darker, this overall. All right, that's pretty dry now. So just a suggestion of that grout line, maybe gets a little heavier or thicker as it gets kind of out this way, more consistent. That's a big pool of water right there. Nothing I can do about that. And here, let me just like this, ever so slightly. Now I'm going to do this horizontal. Basically disappear out this way. That's a little heavy. I want that thinner. You know, the other thing you could consider is maybe the combination of multiple materials. So this might have been a good opportunity to do the color watercolor pencil. That's sometimes maybe just a slight suggestion there. That's good. That's a little heavy. I see it. And it's just a bit too heavy for me. All right. So rather than being overly detailed and too like rigid with those lines, I'm just like loosening them up, letting them kind of fade in and out a little bit. And then I'm going to do another coat. I'm going to use this big round brush. And just dirty water. Just a little. A little bit more through here. Just through here, like so. And maybe out this way, just with some water. And I'll build that up and out. Coming along. A little bit more here. This is still a really wet surface, so I'm just using the moisture that's there to kind of build up. And push it outside. Here too. Just a little bit more water. Just a little more water over this way. Okay, cool. Yeah, that's better. Okay, so switching gears back to the banana itself. I'm gonna work on this yellow that I have. I'm gonna touch up just a little bit of that dark color that I used, just make this just a bit darker, and you just got to commit to the values. So I was gonna, I gotta actually have some paint on here. Well, let me mix out more. So less water, more paint. I'm just gonna try to kind of get back to this color real quick. Okay. I'd just like to kind of test it out, see if there's, you know, if that's in the right family. Without going too dark too quickly. This has to go a lot farther than where it's at right now. So I gotta commit to it. So I think it's more green than where I have it. And this darker green, some of this magenta. There you go. And yeah, that's good. That's giving me that really kind of dense, dark value. I'm just going to rinse my brush out, have a little bit of that paint and color mixed together. If it bleeds a little bit, I'm okay because it's sort of a rounder shape. So it's a bit wet into wet, letting it kind of bloom where it needs to. I think it get a bit out of control for me. That's fine. That's good. I like that. And just up through here. And that carries down up through here. It's all this actually. Just let it go. Use it for that shadow side, like that. A little bit up in here. This one over here. That's pretty yellow. Sort of running out of that paint on my brush, so I can use it to kind of scrub in these lighter areas. A little on the green side, so maybe I need more red in there for the deep shadows. Yeah, I think so. I'm going to pick up some of this magenta, some of this burnt umber, and I'll just make it right here. I can just kind of touch those two together. Make a new pile. It's actually kind of green, so I think that's fine, honestly. Yeah, I think it's fine. But I do think that this red plus a little green would work for some of these other bruises and scars on the surface. Yeah, that's good. That's wet over there. And also just building up that dark color right through here. Just gonna pick up some of this, mix those two. Put that guy in there too. That's good. Adding a little bit of inconsistency to the stem, so that way it doesn't look flat. There's more value to be had here in the kind of greenish area. Like it needs to go darker still. But I'm gonna shift gears and I'm gonna work on the fruit and the inside of the rind and try to get that color. Whereas this yellow was like a lemon yellow, the color of the fruit itself and the rind does have some yellow in it, but it's much more muted. It's much more grayed out. And so to me, what I'm seeing is like a more neutralized version of yellow, and very, very pale. And like the shadow of the banana here is kind of blue. The only issue with mixing blue plus yellow is it ends up looking green. So in order to combat that, I think I'm going to do yellow plus a little violet, which is the complement. And that, I think that'll get me that coolness that I'm looking for on the underside of the fruit. So let me clear out one of these spots. I'm just going to use a paper towel and... I don't really need that one anymore. I'm just gonna this one, I guess. Sorry, I'm just like thinking out loud. There you go. Cool. So this will be yellow here with some violet. That's a lot of violet here. Brown, maybe just a touch of blue in there. Pull it down, and then more yellow. And then more water, lots and lots of water. I'm gonna test this out on my paper. Still too much color. Okay. Yeah, that's okay. It's just a touch more yellow in there. All right, so this is very, very thin. I have one area that is, I feel, very white. So everything else though has color in it. I'm gonna start on this rind here. All right, yeah. So it's a different yellow, and that's what I want. A little grayed out from the violet, but not overly. I'm gonna use more violet when I come into these shadow areas. But for now, I'm just doing like the base color. I'm gonna do that through different areas here. That this down here is definitely really dark, so I'm just gonna have to commit to a big one down there. The banana itself. So I'm staying away from kind of the white area. We're just building up a little bit of like the texture that I'm seeing here. All right. Just sort of like bits of small information in there. I'll just throw those in. All right, so now I'm gonna take some of this violet, hit some of this color there. That's a lot of violet. Just scoop that up, and try to find a clean spot to mix on. Okay. Then we'll switch brushes to my medium round brush here. And I can just kind of pick up a big pile of that. I feel like it's pretty confident about it. A little bit more violet. I don't have a lot of paint in this, so I need to like grab more. Oh, I'll forget it. I'm just gonna use this thing. Make that all just dark. All right. Yeah, okay. This is gonna go a lot darker, so I can use this here on kind of that area of banana. And then, you know, it's just going to take some time to kind of build up the appropriate color and value. You can kind of see that it's starting to happen. I'll just keep going. Sometimes I like to paint with sort of this thicker kind of puddles of paint approach. I find that that helps increase my saturation. So rather than like doing lots of like glazes, I can just like let it pile up and dry out. I like the fluidity of paint. So when it has sort of that feeling like it was a puddle, I personally like that. Some people don't. It's very much in this the way that Conrad Ruiz paints, kind of does this like buildup of puddles of paint. There you go. Same kind of bubbles here. This one's going to go a lot darker, so I'm not touching it too much just yet. Maybe just out here where it looks lighter. And then once I make this darker with some more violet in there, it's going to make the fruit really pop forward. Because right now those two things kind of get lost, and what I need is a little more definition. But the paint is so wet, kind of all over the place, that I have to like let it dry for a second. I think I can also make this cooler, so more blue, maybe this even, like the blue-gray that I used for the negative space. I might put that on there. Let's see what that does. Long wait. Let's keep painting. This is really dark up here, so I need to, commit to that being dark. There. More yellow in it. A lot of violet. I got pretty dark. Just come in here. Part of it too is like, you know, not being afraid of these weird colors. Like, I think it's very much part of the fun of painting. It's getting to experiment and play around with like putting purple where it really has no business being. It's getting a bit of a halo. I want to just bring that right up to the edge there. The paint's kind of pulling because the water is buckling the paper. So all I'm doing is just like propping up the board that I have here. So it's tipping a little bit more kind of away from that corner there. Now, obviously I can like push the paint and then redo that. Okay, that's pretty good. I'm going to try and see what happens with this. Just a little bit of that, just to So I was reading about bananas. And you know, the banana flavor candy doesn't really taste like bananas. But it turns out that it does taste like an older version of a banana that isn't available in the States anymore. So the bananas that we eat taste different than the bananas that like people in the early 20th century ate. Like a different flavor. They're still available, just not as they're not the most popular banana. So that's why the banana candy was developed at the time when those bananas were still available. And so that flavor of banana candy doesn't taste like the bananas that we eat. I thought that was interesting. I'm going through. Yeah, let's just go for purple. I'm just gonna go for some real purple up in here. Yeah, like that. So at this point, I'm not really too concerned with like true color. I mean, I'm just using it as a general guide. But if things go kind of off, I think that's fine too. Some just coolness over here. I'm just using this that dark blue, which was really what I used for this negative space. I'm just kind of adding it in a few areas here and there. So this more green there, some yellow, maybe some of that brown too. I like pushing the paint around. I think it's a little too green still. Fill it out a bit. Fluid. Oh, that's good. Putting the paint away too much right there. So that's looking pretty good. I need to, like, the peel here, I can bring some yellow back into it. It looks a bit brown. Oh, weird. I have like birds attacking my window right now. There's a lot of birds outside. Sorry, I'm kind of distracted. I need to kind of build up some of that color back in here. It's a little too pale, so I think a bit more color will help. And I feel like I need to push this negative space some more. So I think I'm going to come in and get that darker with more of this bluish color. And that's really going to help that banana start to like pop forward. So let's do some of this. So that was this color here. I'm just going to pick up some yellow and kind of get in there and mix those two together. So. A little more yellow than that. That greenish, what happened? Yeah, it's too green. I think I like polluted it with, I don't think I cleaned my brush well enough. So I'll just start a new pile here. That color looks close enough. Just a little bit of violet in there. There you go. Yeah. All right, so that's just gonna give me a little bit more color in some of these areas here. There are some lighter spots and darker spots that I can still pick up on. But I just wanna even this out a touch. I don't want to go too heavy on this. I kind of like the way that the banana is looking in terms of color. But I can maybe just hit just hints here and there. All right, cool. I'm gonna go back to my big flat brush here and just start building in some of these, like this area here with some of this color. I'm just gonna lay it down. I want to avoid kind of just outlining around it. So I have to like make sure I'm trying to block it in as best I can. Just fade that out a little as it comes out this way. That banana, the shape that it needs. A little light right in the corner. I like that. There's a little weird bit of Ryan there. I'm just gonna omit it. Just go finer brush in there. Maybe just leave some of that. I feel like that one, the round flat brush was like wiping things away. So I can just like let it pull up a bit. Cool. Okay. Better. We need some just right in here. Just for some sharpness. So that's all, I mean, that right there is looking pretty good. I think I can come in and just even some of this out a bit. Like this, I like that. I like the relationship between the unpeeled part and the negative space. Like it has the clarity that I think it needs. I do think I can go darker here. This and this look too close. So one of these needs to go darker, either this or this. So I have to kind of make that decision. They're too similar. So I think a bit more sharpness there, a bit even in terms of the color up here. I think it's a little patchy and confusing. So simplifying it out would help kind of calm down the splotchiness. But it looks like a banana. And I think that's that's kind of the important thing. Yeah. And so the approach that I'm using here is, you know, I really want to make sure that I'm examining things. I'm looking at my painting as it's progressing forward and thinking about, what can I do to make this better? How can I approach the painting in a way that's like not just sort of resting on my laurels, like, yeah, I copied a banana and yeah, I made it yellow, but instead, well, what else does it need? Like, where else can I go with this painting? And that's one of the challenges of, you know, of painting on your own. And in a class, it's like, how do you know if you're on the right track? And one of the easiest things that I find to do is to walk away. If you walk away from your painting, give it like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, let your eyes reset, think about something else, and then come back and stand like 15 feet away from it. And just look at it and just say, well, what does this need? Like, what's it missing? And I feel like that's maybe the most kind of beneficial approach to this, because it'll reset your brain. It'll reset your eyes. And it'll let you see things that maybe when you're sort of intensely working on something, it's hard to see. Like, you can't see the forest for the trees, right? You got to get back. You got to get some space from it. That saying never made sense to me until I started like painting and drawing. But it's true. You got to like see the bigger picture. Everything's a little bit too wet for me to work on. It's okay. I'm just gonna use the same blue here. It's kind of doing its thing. I think I'm gonna make the banana darker here and pull these outward this way. I'm going to use the same color here. There's a bit of a shadow here. It's a little heavy. I gotta pull some of that material up and off a bit. Yeah, just knock it down some, soften it out. Same right here, soften it out that way. This can go darker too. I think right there, yeah. There. And I'll make that dark. So that was I working with violets and stuff? I'm gonna work with violet, light yellow, well, whatever that is. Just make this sit further behind. Same thing here. I need to go further back. So I'm just looking for opportunities to make adjustments, kind of fix things, make it read the way that it should read. Right up in there. Move those purples out this way, that way. It's a little intense, but you can kind of mess around with it. Use that same brownish color in there too. That's good. I'm gonna fade this out a little bit. Just pick up some of the kind of textural kind of things here. And here. Good. This light green. Let's see if I can. I need to really let that set up. My brushes are scrubbing the paint off. So I have to let it like build up and completely dry. I just picked it up with a finger. No, that's weird looking. This purple down here is a little too much. So I'm just gonna pick up some of that brown, some of this yellow that I had around, and I'll just kind of dull that out. Make it more brownish rather than just fully purple. And just kind of carry some of those colors a little bit over to other things, and then they won't feel as like alien to the rest of the painting. All right, what do I think? I think it's looking pretty good. Good. Right up there. I think I could still go further with that negative space. It seems a little too light. So I think I'm going to push that negative space through the whole thing. Because I'm squinting down the main photo, and there's a big difference between this area and this area. And right now, when I squint at the drawing, they're too similar in value. So I need to step this down a little bit darker, which would in turn step down all of this slightly darker as well. And yeah, I think that would be my next sort of course of action here. But I have to wait. Because everything's still just a little too wet, and I don't want it to like bleed all over the place. Where am I? I'm here somewhere. There I am. I'm going to continue this painting beyond this. And I'll post up the pictures. I'll take a photo of it right now, and then I'll take pictures of it sort of in progress. And I should be done in the next couple of days. And I'll upload it to the module. Like I said before, I will be uploading all of these Zoom sessions to my personal YouTube page. I will be sending out a link to it. If you just search me on YouTube, I think I come up. I'm the only person interested in myself. So you can look that up and I should pop up. But I will send a direct link and you'll have access to that. And I'll set that up soon. This has been a really wonderful class. Thank you everyone for participating. Thank you for being a part of it. Hopefully you continue to paint. I really hope I didn't discourage anyone from doing that.
No, you haven't discouraged me. I'm still doing it.
Okay, great. I hope you all have a great summer. Please feel free to reach out to me. Like, send me whatever you're working on. Send me stuff. And I'm always curious and interested. Yes.
Can I show you what you did today?
Sure. Yeah.
You see what it says?
Oh, cool. it's hard to make out what it says, but
it's okay. It's really depressing, so it's fine that you don't see it.
Okay. but that's fun. I like the letters in the
videos.
Yeah.
Well, how do we get a hold of you to email yourself and find out if you're coming back?
I think they'll make announcements, I'm sure, like, because every time that there's a new instructor, no one really trusts who they are. People like working with the same people. So there's like a big push from the school to like showcase whoever's coming up. So I know that when I started, they were really trying to have the other instructors promote me to students so that way they'd join the class and it wouldn't get canceled. So if I do come back, I'm sure you'll hear an announcement at some point. Just kind of look out. But I do recommend, I don't know I do recommend taking classes with other instructors. They offer, the more exposure you have to other people and other ideas, the kind of better you get at everything. So please check them out if you haven't already. And see what
I'm signed up for fall and one in the summer.
Okay, great. Yeah. And then also, you know, hopefully you all sort of see each other in other classes and, yeah, you know, you're helping each other along. So that's a great thing too.
Yeah.
So on that note, I think we'll wrap it up here. Have a great summer.
Thank you.
Have a great every day, guys.
Yeah. Thank all right, everyone. You. Bye.
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 Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, Mark.